months.
You know, and what happens is when somebody publicly says, I want to be traded, like with John Wall, you almost have to trade him.
Right.
You know, because it's going to be an issue in the locker room. And you know, you saw what happened with James Harden. And you know, if I were Houston, I would have said, screw you. You know, you were paying you millions of dollars, play. But you're right, Jason, that once a guy says, I'm done here, I want to go, you almost have to get rid of him.
Right. Like, Houston should say, I don't care what you want, Deshaun Watson. We just signed you to a huge deal. You're playing here. But they may have to get rid of him. They may have to trade him.
They once a guy goes public in today's world and says, I want out, you know, you almost have to let him out. And he can make the case, and he's made the case, and will continue to make the case, I think, until he does get traded, that he was lied to by management. And once a player starts saying that, then you've got a real issue. You've got an issue in the locker room. Now, maybe the new coach comes in and sits him down and says, here's what we're going to do. Here's why we're going to win with you. And that might change. I doubt it.
Yeah.
But that's if I'm the new coach, and I still don't know why they didn't hire Eric Bieniemy, but if I'm the new coach, that's the first thing I do. I see if there's some way to keep Deshaun Watson on the team. Because like I said, you got one of the five or six best quarterbacks in football. You're going back to square one if you have to trade him.
All right, John, good stuff as always. We'll talk to you next week.
All right, look forward to it, guys. Have a great weekend.
See you, bud.
Thanks, John. John Feinstein, best-selling author, Washington Post columnist. Remember, still got Ryan Zimmerman. He'll join us at 9 o'clock as we talk some Nationals. But coming up next, it's Cakes' entertainment page.
That's
right. He's going to fill us in on how much cash the weekend is spending on a Super Bowl halftime show next here on The Fan.
Thousand shares. I nubbed it and bought 10.
Okay.
All right. So I put about $1,500 in.
Right.
But apparently, and it was kind of hovering around a 125 to 128. It got up to like 132, 133 earlier in the week.
Okay.
But then I guess after the market closed yesterday, there was some surge. Maybe they announced like the phase three in their vaccine progression. And it's at 206 right now.
You're loving that. You love that pop.
So it jumped 72 points, $72 yesterday. And I'm thinking, I might just sell it and get out. I only got 10 shares.
Maybe that's the move.
I don't know about phase three, but the report came out last night that it was like 90% effective against the strain, the second strain.
Oh, okay. Well, whatever it was good news, obviously, because the market reacted.
Look, I know nothing about stocks and stonks, but you bought this within the last year, right?
Yeah.
Like if you buy and sell within a year, don't you pay more like on a capital gains tax? I think.
Probably, yeah.
Like you might want to take that into consideration.
I don't.
Okay.
Because what if in 6 months after that year expires, it goes back down to 125?
Okay. It's just something you have to consider.
No, again, I'm not really.
I'm an armchair guy. I know nothing.
It's doubled. It's on a run.
I know.
He's not in it for the long haul.
Yeah, I'm not going to wait. I have 10 shares. I don't have a million shares.
Okay.
I got 10 shares.
Cakes is such a traditionalist. He's a 10-year holder.
I'm mostly Cakes a buy and a hold dog.
Cakes is the hedge fund manager in all this.
Oh, I am. Yeah. I'm the bad guy.
You're
I'm the villain.
You're not a stonk guy.
Yeah. Hey, that's fine. I can live with not being a stonk
you're not
guy.
You're not a retail trader.
That's okay. I'm fine with that.
Now, I might sell it right when the market opens, and maybe it goes up to 250 and I lose even more money, but I think I just got to take the profit.
It sounds like a good move to me, but I don't know the repercussions. Again, I am a dinosaur when it comes to the stocks.
I'll deal with the taxes later. I don't care about that.
Right.
I just want to know that I made some money on it.
Yeah, you deal with that down there. You kick that can straight down the road.
Drabby, what do you think I should do? Should I just sell it at 206 when it opens, or should I wait it out?
I think today's a great day to cash out.
It might go up, though.
You're going to be so bitter when it's at 500 a share in a year and a half.
Believe me, I expect that. That's just my luck.
I know, right. But here's what you got to come to terms with. You'll never sell at the highest. If you come to terms with that and you're happy with the money you made, then sell.
Yeah. Well, I've got about an hour to think about
it. Drab's got diamond hands.
I do have diamond hands.
Very good.
Now, if I had 200 shares, 500 shares, well, then I would sell a portion of the shares.
You know what you should do, Jason?
Yeah.
You should sell and then invest in a soundproof room. Because all I hear is a vacuum going on.
Well,
in the background.
That's my girl Lourdes is here. You've met Lourdes. She comes once a month, and today's her day, and she does come early. I apologize. But I got to get the fur up. Dog's fur is everywhere. I got to get it up.
Has she been vacuuming outside your office for 45 minutes?
No, she's upstairs.
Oh, my God.
You have some paper-thin walls.
Hey, I don't know what to tell you. It's a powerful vacuum.
She's got a silly Hoover.
She's got the biggest Hoover in demand.
All right, let's switch gears. Let's open up the entertainment page with old Johnny Cakes taking us through it. Still sponsored by Wave Soda. Wave Soda is awesome. Super simple, just bubbly water. With a splash of real juice and a little caffeine, it's unsweetened. So no stevia artificial sweeteners, just a clean finish with only 2 to 6 grams of sugar and 15 to 25 calories per can. Enter code JUNKIES. You get 15% off at wavesoda.com.
All right, I know Jason Bishop is generally disinterested in the entertainment page, but this story, the lead story, is going to make him snap to attention.
Just you always find good ones. Bickle, I don't know what he finds. It's putting me to sleep.
Well,
but
I'll find
good ones.
I will give all credit to one, the Matt and Matt show, who sent the stories my way.
Imagine how entertaining Eric's EP would be if he would do the stories we send him.
If he read it.
Yeah.
If he prepared.
All right, so The Weeknd is doing the Super Bowl halftime show. I can't call him The Weeknd because he's missing an E in his name.
Yes.
Okay, but he's a massive superstar.
Can you play
obviously.
The song? Can you play his great song?
This song, Valdez, by the please. Way, that Valdez is about to play, Blinding yeah. Lights.
Yeah, great song.
I'm convinced it is a great song. It's super catchy. Mm-hmm. I'm convinced the only people on planet Earth that haven't heard this at this point, it might be every once in a while you see the story about, well, there was this tribe that somebody discovered, like in Brazil, and you see like an overhead shot of them wearing like loincloths and carrying spears to kill their food.
They got the big hoops through their nose. Yeah.
And they don't have Hulu. They don't have internet. Like, they have nothing, okay?
Right.
They may be the only people on the planet that haven't heard this song.
Do you think those people could possibly be as happy as somebody like Deshaun Watson who's going to be making $40 million
no.
a year?
They have Impossible. No concept of money. They don't know what capitalism is.
I understand that, but maybe they're happier. You don't think that's possible?
Because they don't know anything else?
No. Living in the jungle with no creature comforts? Impossible.
But they don't know what the comforts are. They don't know they
yeah.
exist.
Like, they don't hear this silliness going through their earphones
that is
and their
true.
Headphones.
Yeah, but they're not worrying about missing out on stocks.
They know nothing about stonks. That is true.
They're not swept away by all of the kind of stresses in life.
They don't know what's going on with Robin Hood. Now they're trying to job the little guy. They don't know any of that.
Now,
they're not worrying about
their
streaming bills.
Right.
They're not worried about it. They're paying for Hulu and Disney Plus.
But their lives are worse because they don't have this chorus rattling around in their brain.
It's a good tune.
I mean, it's so good.
Now, is The Weeknd going to be playing in the stadium, or is it going to be at like some outside, you know,
I would assume
studio.
He's going to be in the stadium. And the story is that he's dipping into his own pocket to make it a bigger theatrical show, I guess, because, like, I guess Pepsi is just like, here's your budget. This is what we're going to pay, you know, for you to put on the halftime show. And he's like, well, that's not going to do. $7 million of his own money. He's going to pour into the Super Bowl halftime show next weekend. Next weekend.
Weekend, right.
I mean, $7 million of your own money. I understand why he's doing it. He's investing in himself. This is the biggest gig of his lifetime. These are going to be the most eyeballs that will ever be on him at any time.
Mm-hmm.
Because last year's Super Bowl halftime with J-Lo and Shakira, I believe, drew 102 million viewers.
Mm-hmm.
Like, you're never going to get a bigger audience. And that, you know, it boosts your streams. It obviously boosts your worldwide profile. But he's going $7 million into his own pocket to make it a more cinematic experience for the viewers. I'm
wow.
kind of intrigued. I feel like I have to watch now.
Well, he's got
to
be worth $200 million.
I don't know what The Weeknd is worth. I couldn't.
The Weeknd has got to be. He's got to be triple digits.
I mean, never looked at his net worth.
If you're going to spend $7 million, well, you probably got $150 million in the bank.
So dovetailing off this story, I was like, okay, where is Blinding Lights on the Billboard charts? Now, I haven't looked at the Billboard charts in a long time. So I pulled up the top five, and it's at number four right now. And the number one song, I think it's been number one for at least a week or two, is Driver's License by Olivia Rodrigo. I'll just tell you, I've never felt more out of touch because I don't believe I've ever heard this song.
It was one of the fastest songs on Spotify to like 100 million. Yeah.
I don't think I've ever heard it either. Ariana Grande's 2, 34 plus 35. I'm
finally drive up to your house, but today I drove through the suburbs crying because you weren't around.
Have you heard that, Kings?
I've not.
I don't think I've heard it.
I think it's kind of catchy, actually.
Valdez lives for playing this song, the sound effects.
I like it.
You do like that?
I think she's a good building up. I mean, she sounds good.
I mean, she can sing, but I don't think it's that catchy.
Hasn't gotten to the hook yet.
Well, I hate to break it to you, but there's not much hook.
There's no hook?
This is the hook.
Not my cup of tea.
I'd rather lose my driver's license than listen to this.
I may be in the minority.
Good sing, Jason.
You guys seem to be fans of The Weeknd.
Yes,
I put a poll. We do our
it's a great song.
Poll of the day, brought to you by Van Meter Homes, and it's whether you're psyched for The Weeknd doing the halftime show at the Super Bowl, or it's meh. To me, it's
Blinding
meh.
Lights by The Weeknd is Gonzaga, and that driver's license song is like University of San Diego.
It does crush that song. And by the way, rounding out your top five, Jason mentioned song number two. That's 34 plus 35. By my math, that's 69. Right. That's Ariana Grande featuring Doja Cat and
I wonder what's
Megan
on her mind.
The Stallion. At number three, you've got Mood, 24 Golden featuring Ian Dior. Don't know who that is. And at five, you have Ariana Grande with Positions. So, in case you've never felt more out of touch.
She's thinking about 69 in Positions in her two top songs.
Apparently, yes. That's
talking about shortstop.
It's obviously a good formula for success.
Right, 6-4-3. That's what she's thinking about, right?
Now, speaking of success, we'll pivot over to Netflix. You don't know the biggest score they've made, their biggest series ever, Jason. Care to guess?
No, I would not. I would have no clue.
EB would not be sized. It's a period piece, period flick. It is Bridgerton. Apparently,
my wife has watched it and she loves it.
Whoa!
It's a drama set in Britain in the early 1800s.
That's a little nugget, Jason. Because that show is basically Skinamax porno.
Oh, it is.
Oh yeah.
Well, she loves it for some reason.
Well, I bet.
I bet she does.
By the way, this sounds like something I would never, ever, ever watch. Set in 1813 London at the end of Britain's Georgian era, it's easy to see how the show's sex scene, scandal, and period costumes would propel it to success. Second season already confirmed.
Good. But who's the star? Would I know any of the stars?
How would I? I have no idea. I would have to pull up the cast. I have no idea.
I think they eclipsed 82 million streams.
Wow.
So that's...
Cakes, I watched a movie, an 11-year-old movie yesterday. For some reason, when I logged into Netflix, it popped up.
All right.
Like it was the top suggestion for me.
Okay.
And it's called The Next 3 Days. You ever see that?
The Next 3 Days. It's not ringing a bell.
It's got Russell Crowe and Elizabeth Banks, who's a smoking hottie. And it's got Olivia Wilde. It's an interesting movie. I think you'd like it. Ending kind of got me. I wasn't happy with the ending, but the whole story is pretty cool.
Instant Johnny Flakes movie review, since you brought up Russell Crowe.
Yeah.
I rented along with and watched it with two of my kids, Unhinged, the road rage movie Russell Crowe.
Is that good?
My first takeaway is that it looks like Russell Crowe 8 Commodus from Gladiator.
Oh, right.
He's so big.
He's a hefty.
He's really big. Yeah.
I think
movie.
That was for the role, though.
I think it was probably for the role.
I mean, he's like 300 pounds.
But I'll just say that he really went for it as far as packing on the pounds.
I enjoyed that film.
I enjoyed it. I give it a solid 4 cake batters.
Really?
Yes.
Is it better than Falling Down? Isn't it the same thing as Falling Down, Michael Douglas, back in the day?
It's along the same line.